Good Western morning. Yeah, good morning, everyone. Good morning. And welcome to the session, Why Not Open? A double session. So if you've got stamina, that's awesome. Or if you need to duck away half time, we won't really mind too much. But we'll be, well, we actually know we'll be wounded, but yeah.
Yeah.
Such is life.
Just write the URL for this. So
oh, thank you. We've already popped the outline for the session that we've worked on in the Google Doc. And we're going to start, I mean, you can see what we've got planned. We're going to start by looking at the difference between free and open, because someone, I can't remember who was it pointed out first, was it Richard? Hi, Richard, do you want to say hello on the chat stream? He's probably gone to make a cup of coffee. Never mind. No, anyway. Richard pointed out that Google Docs are free to use, but they are not open. And I just said to Dave, I'm not sure of the difference. So
that was a big can of worms just being open.
So I started learning from Dave and finding that out. So we have got an etherpad, that's right, Nigel.
Yep.
We have the etherpad set up and we're working in there, which is not only free but also open. I think I'm correct in saying. So just before we get started though, we did have a plan. And the plan was, we can't see it there. Do you want to scroll down a bit, Nigel?
Down.
To see who's in the room and what everyone's background is. So,
can I just very quickly say that if anyone in the session wants to access this, just go to that URL. Note that's a lowercase h for HUI. If you go to that, all you need to do is go to that in a browser and you'll be able to edit this document. And if you go to the upper right-hand corner with the color there, you'll have a different color on yours and you can add your name and then you'll know exactly who's entered what text.
And there is a link. So, there is a link to the Etherpad in the on the program page, as well as a Google Doc. So you can just go there and click on it.
Yeah. So because we had a plan and we're going to follow up for the first 5 minutes at least, and then you know, what's this phrase with planning? Planning's everything. Following the plan's nothing. Where is everyone from? Anyone here from education, primary, secondary, tertiary, or other? Yes, we have, for the benefit, I don't know, oh, our cameraman is panning for the benefit of everyone in the room. Online, guys, education, I think some of you are. If anything comes up in the chat stream, obviously we're going to be trying to look it out to you, but you'll see this. So can someone just go wave if we miss something? So we've got some education people there. Business, IT, industry, or other? Yep, a good smattering, quite a large chunk, actually. The glam sector, best, most awesome name sector, galleries. It was coined apparently by the National Library and Penn Academy, and it's taken on the world because who doesn't want to say they're in the glam sector? I think that's right. It could be just apocryphal. Government, anyone from government apart from me and a couple hiding down the back and possibly a colleague coming on online from DIA who wanted to be here but couldn't make the journey north. NGOs. A few as well. And anyone not already class themselves as other? Oh, yes, yay, awesome. So, okay, moving on.
What does other count as?
Makerspace, yeah. Awesome. Cool. So, cool. I haven't ever facilitated a session with a chat running in the background. So we're going to hope, the crucial thing is that we use the mics. It's only fair to everyone online. We have two, and then also this is mic'd up here too, so you can come and join in with that. Education, yay, thanks Wayne. But I think if we just jump straight in, Dave's whispering with Kevin, but if we jump straight in, and Dave, if you could give the tutorial on open versus free, please. I made some notes as best I could going along, but away you go.
Okay, so for people in the open source and free software world, this is kind of a discussion we have very often, but there's an unfortunate quirk of the English language that the word free connotes both freedom and free of cost. In other languages, thankfully, they have words like libre and gratis to separate the two concepts very unambiguously. However, the world of marketing has been very quick to leap on the sexiness of the concept of free when it comes to software and virtual things, and so they have very rapidly diluted its value as a word to use. before open source software. So how many people haven't heard of open source software? Anyone? Everyone's heard of it. Open source software, believe it or not, is actually a planned brand name that was used to replace free software because of that ambiguity. Free software predates open source software. Free software, in this case, is software which preserves freedom. It does not actually connote that it is free of cost, although that is typically also the case, but that is not what it means. So free software, contrary to what most people think, is not non-commercial software. It could be commercial and also free software, because the free, as I said, refers to the freedom of, in this case, not so much the freedom of the developer, but rather the freedom of the user, because free software assumes that the user is the developer. It doesn't see a distinction between the two, and it wants to ensure that that is always possible to be the case. Does that make sense to everyone? The idea that if you're using free software, you are empowered to be a developer of that software should you choose to be so. If you see something that doesn't work with it, you can fix it. The concept of open source and open in the context of software came about because the word open was seen as having fewer ambiguities, and the idea of open source was coined also to make the idea of free software more palatable to the business world, because it was seen as a bit anarchistic, and it was actually accused of being communistic, although it's anything but. The idea behind open source is that it focuses more on the methodology of developing software in which the source code of the software is available for anyone to see and to modify. However, it is focused more that over time the meaning of open source has diverged somewhat from the meaning of free. As I've drawn up here, you might not be able to see the blue line so well, but all free software is also open source, but not all open source software is also free software. So just to cloud the waters a wee bit, maybe. What that means is that there are some types of open source software which preserve the freedom of the developer over the freedom of the user. Those are what are referred to, and it depends on your perspective of whether they are more free or less free. If you're the user, then they're less free. If you're a developer, they're more free, because some of those open source software types, which are distinguished by their licensing, the copyright license that applies to the code, those open source packages can be re-released as proprietary software, which is the opposite of open source or free software. And so what they do is they allow a business, for example, to take open source software that's available under one of those licenses and convert it into proprietary software and then sell it back, in theory, to the people who originally gave it to the commons. So, for example, any of you who are using an Apple, Apple is built on a free operating system called the Mach 32 kernel. It's also known as Darwin. Apple rebranded it as Darwin. Darwin is an open source project, but it is not free software. And what Apple has done is it effectively has closed it and has then sold it back to the very people who wrote it. So the people who wrote the Mach kernel now have to buy it from Apple because they gave them that right by the license that they used to release their code. Apple's not built on Linux because Linux has a free software license. It uses the most common free software license called the general public license. So anyway, so Linux preserves the freedom of the user. Apple preserves the freedom of the developer to exploit the software at the expense of the user. Make sense? Okay. Does anybody have any questions at this stage? Okay. Why not open?
Okay. Very good question. I'm going to slip to this one because it's that way I can tab between the two. Okay. Why not? Why open? Why not? Using free of price, technical, and most legal restrictions on reuse as a working description, this is a session aimed at all creators, providers, and consumers on the internet. So we're looking at the questions, why do some businesses, agencies, researchers, and educators adopt openness and some don't? What are the behaviours that enable openness? What are the incentives and the barriers to greater use or provision of open resources? What's the value of, for example, open software, open educational resources, open access, open data, open science, and open government? What are your stories of success or otherwise? So, the topic. So coming back to where we were, someone's fixing something, the thing for me. Thanks. Good on you. I knew that was wrong. so we want to talk about the definition of open, or did you have a... Go for it.
Some other sessions have sort of lacked focus, and I think I thought that was quite broad, and I think sort of going along with the theme of the question being asked, is there anyone in the room who feels that there is a challenge to using either open source or the open principle?
Hello. I think the challenge for a lot of people, especially in the corporate world, is that what it demands is a level of ownership, especially with their IT systems. And I see a lot of people in IT, a lot of businesses, actually don't want to own it. They want to give it to somebody else. I think that's wrong, but I think that's a fundamental issue, is that level of ownership and control that you have to have and responsibility, a lot of people just don't want that, which is very sad.
When you say ownership, are you referring to the liability aspect of the ownership? Just to clarify.
Not necessarily liability, but the fact that you do have to, you know, own your solution. You have to own your solution.
Look after it.
Yeah. Rather than letting other people look after it for you. The other side I don't like about it is the tribalism. But that's probably another problem.
In the model of having to own your solution, if you take off the shelf commercial software, or you take open source prepackaged software that someone else has developed, and you then modify that to create your product, whatever it is, you still own that product. You can't say, this is my website, but I'm not responsible for it because I used Microsoft's web server or because I used Apache. You've put up that content. So how does it being open source versus not open source change in that respect?
Well, can I just say one very quick thing? One of the interesting dilemmas of the open world has faced is that the exploitative nature, and I say this with all of the loadedness that comes with, the exploitative nature of proprietary software means that there is a lot of money floating around the ecosystem, or the monocultures that are created around proprietary software products. And one of the side effects of that is that there are a lot of people who can create businesses and make a living from supporting those things, because there's so much money going through, even clipping the ticket for a small amount of money allows them to build a profitable business. The problem with open things is that there is much less money in the ecosystem because the money is being made by the people who use the software, not by the people who produce the software. Does that make sense? And as a result, there are a lot of people who are very entrenched in supporting and building things that exploit exploit proprietary software because they can make a lot more money doing it at the expense of society as a whole, because the money that is going to the software vendors is not going to the people who use the software to produce valuable things. Does that make sense? So there's a disincentive for people to support free and open source things because they have to then be accountable for the full cost of their capability, of their service. So rather than having the selling a Microsoft Windows license and getting a 30% cut like most vendors of Microsoft products do, that 30% cut has to be the explicit price of that vendor's support of a free service. And the expectation that's been set by the free and open source world, unfortunately for many in business, is that it's free, and therefore the support should be free. And if they're paying that equivalent amount of the margin that the coalface IT support person would get to support the proprietary system, it seems like a big cost relative to the $0 that they're spending on the free software. Does that make sense?
I'm just conscious we've jumped into towards the end of where we were planning to be.
Okay.
and we've also gone down the software opens. We were going to talk about what open means, and also who's doing things that are open, because we did start by encompassing open lots of things was my thing, open research g- government, what were the other things, education, open data, open access, open educational resources, and not just software. So, Nigel, do you think we need to talk a bit more about what we mean when we say open?
I think.
Do we have agreement in the room? What do you think open means? Should we just chuck it out there?
I think that was certainly our initial thinking, that, you know, although Peter, I asked the question earlier if everybody was reasonably happy with open, but I'm not sure whether we all have the same concept of openness. So I think that was where we were thinking we might really sort of kick off, so that we start to see what the different perspectives are and what open means.
I'd also add in that I'm speaking as someone who came to NetHui for the first time about 3 years ago, it still really helps me, and I'm quite happy to play the village idiot and ask the questions about, oh, I don't understand this. So apologies to those of you who are
Can I just address that? Yeah. So,
don't put yourself down. Oh, that's right. So I think
Jacob
was next, but
So going back to the definition of what open means. So Lawrence Lessig talks about the read-only versus the read-write culture, and I think that sums up things quite well. What we're interested in doing is being able to enable people not only as of consumers of things, but as creators of things. So whether you're talking about software or books or music or anything else, you know, hardware, these things, what we're trying to do is enable people to create their own things, create their own output, rather than just consuming the output that's been given to them. And I think that's really the core ethos of what open means.
Read only versus rewrite.
Sorry, I had it in my head, then I completely lost it. I was trying to listen. Jacob?
So, I agree with Peter, yeah. And when talking about the open, free, I think within this room, I think it would be fair to say when we talk about open and free, we're talking about in a general Libra context, you know, the liberal sense of the word. But in general terms, this whole scene, to me, is built on a hierarchy of values. And it starts with free culture, it starts with open standards, open protocols, open data. And open source is important to me because this is the world I live in, but it is the inevitable product of all of these values. That's where we'd head to. But I can't see we reaching that point where we could have ubiquitous open source, which would be ideal, without respecting and promoting and even enforcing the underlying principles, such as trying to compel our governments, who we pay our tax money to, when they fund research projects, to make sure that those research projects are contributed back into the commons. That when we work with governments and we submit data, that we do it using open formats over open protocols and on open systems, so that we as a society can then draw on that legacy down the line.
Elements of openness then, elements of open that Jaco picked up on then were open research. Can someone yell out the others?
So free culture, open data, open protocols, open standards.
Protocols. So can you just, for those of us who might need an explanation, in a sentence, open protocols are... And open standards are?
The internet is open protocols.
TCP/IP
is an open protocol.
The idea behind it is that, the things that define the way different technologies and different concepts talk to each other are protocols.
English.
And they're a language to talk to between different systems. And if those protocols are defined and they're published, anyone without needing permission from anyone can implement something which knows how to talk those things. Whereas in many cases, otherwise, you have proprietary gatekeepers who you have to get permission from before you can do these things.
Yeah.
So it's permission. To me, the concepts that are key to openness are the ideas of permissionless innovation and the idea that everything surrounds a commons. Okay, so I think commons is really the crucial aspect. So the idea of something that is everyone's property as opposed to something which is only one person's proprietary property.
Yeah, thanks. I'm just conscious I want to make sure everyone in the room has the vocabulary that we're going forward, because it's very easy to, even something like TCIP, I've heard that, I can spell it. And it doesn't mean that I actually really know what it is.
Okay, I'll send you a diagram on it later.
We want people to stay in the discussion in the room. Yeah.
Okay, there's one other open that I'm really keen on, and that is open hardware. And to me, and I'm going to actually rave for a minute here. I'm going to stand up the front and join the panel, elect myself. Okay. In the early 1980s, I bought an expensive leather lounge suite, brand new. 6 months later, one of the chairs, came detached and tied. There was a massively under-engineered little screw that held the whole damn thing together. Since then, on a number of occasions, I've bought products that looked solid, that cost a lot of money, and some trivial little bit of plastic inside broke, which I've actually rather modestly formulated as Clement's Law, which states that inside every $1,000 appliance is a 20-cent plastic piece that breaks and can't be replaced. Now, if you go back to the dawn of history, in fact, before the dawn of history, to the Neolithic, our ancestors could themselves, or one of their family members living in the same village, could make for them every single piece of the toolkit that they depended on. You know, stone tools, wooden tools, bits of antler, whatever. Someone in the village, a cousin, knew how to make it. You all worked together, and everything you needed, you could make. These days, that's not true. However, and it's a bit shame that none of the RepRap people I recognise are here today, there's a movement which... You're RepRap? Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to sing the praises of RepRap. RepRap is a 3D printer project, but it's a lot more than that. It is making a 3D printer that the ultimate aim is it can make other 3D printers. And that takes us back to what I call the new Neolithic. We get back to the point where someone in your global village will have a set of plans that you can download and you can print off. And, you know, never again will I have to throw away a $1,000 automatic coffee machine because some little irreplaceable plastic part that can only be obtained in Italy has broken. And because I'll just be able to find the plans for it and print it. And at which point I become as self-sufficient, or at least my family becomes as self-sufficient, as my ancestors were back in Europe when they were first learning how to herd sheep.
There's a couple of folks back there. Just before I hand it over, since I actually have the mic, I think one of the things I picked up from Jacko earlier, was it isn't just about whether it's hardware or software or whatnot. A lot of this is values driven, and I think Wayne's put this down in the chat here: the value of sharing knowledge freely. So we might come back to that. But there were a couple of folks back here had their hand up.
Actually, I just want to write something here. Right. One of the things that was mentioned earlier that isn't on the board yet is open data, so that we can share data. But absolutely crucial to that is having the standards for sharing the data as well as open standards.
Formats.
Yeah.
Yeah. Watch openstandards.nz over the next couple of days.
I come from the business side of open source, and I've worked in several open source businesses, JBoss, Red Hat, Alfresco, Silverstripe, and Squiz. And for me, it's as a salesperson, it's really about the ethics of concentrating on the delivery of quality implementations of software that actually changes the way that actually enables the business to make a digital transformation or make a transformation in their business processes. And it's about the honesty of actually charging money, not for software at all, but for actually the experience and the services of the implementation. Because my grandmother can download code, but she's not the best choice to maintain it for a major bank. You might want a couple of adults to do that for you. Some of you fine people.
Well, One of the interesting things that openness has done is it's put into stark relief the place where value actually exists. So that's where so most people are used to paying for software, but someone pointed out to me once when back in the days when you bought software with a CD-ROM, you could buy a CD-ROM of Windows or of Microsoft Office and you could have it sitting in a box on a shelf and it was of zero value to anyone, even though you'd exchanged the money for that box. It was only when you installed it, you knew how to use it, you were able to produce something of value that it had value to you. So the idea was that the value is actually not what you were paying for. And what Open seems to do is it seems to be changing it so that the value is the thing that people spend the money on. But it's a matter now of overcoming old habits of buying some physical thing, because now we're at, that's something, there's concepts that are important. Artificial scarcity is one that that openness challenges, which is how most exploitative software business models work, for example. Things like planned obsolescence, which is what Bruce was talking about. We don't want planned obsolescence, that's wasteful. It's against the user's interest, the consumer's interest. But anyway, that's...
I thought I'd put a pin in the bubble. I'm a former president of the New Zealand Open Source Society, so obviously I have an interest in open source. But I don't think it's all love and goodness, unfortunately. I think there is a serious problem around not only the open source software model, but other open models with regards to being able to... essentially what Dave was talking about is the monetization aspect. And the fact is that there were a lot of trouble trying to find business models around open source. And the ones that we look to, I mean, there's Red Hat, which is, produces a service model around it, which has kept to its core values. But the biggest companies in the world now are people like Amazon, Facebook, Google. They're all using open source. They're not necessarily contributing back. I mean, they do obviously help our society, and I think, you know, there's a bit of synergy there. But the problem is that openness in itself isn't providing the value. And we've just come out of we're seeing the destruction of journalism, for example, which I'm very personally worried about, because I think there really is a value in having professional journalists taking an unbiased analysis of what's going on and not letting everyone, you know, they're basically acting as a curator for the information so that you can get a more pure incoming stream of information that's been verified. So having a whole lot of blogs isn't really the solution. And similarly with open source, I think, yes, there's a lot of open source projects out there. Not all of them really are focused on users. Unfortunately, I have an old saying that the price of entry is pain. And not all open source is like that. There are some very good open source projects, but too many open source projects have a steep learning curve and are very developer focused because it's the developers who are making them. And I think, yes, I obviously love open source, and I think it's done absolute wonders for the world. Our internet's completely based on it. It's going to win. It has won. It's fantastic. But we can't ignore the downsides. We can't ignore the problem that it's also destroyed a lot of value and a lot of perceived value from society in general, in terms of devaluing the value of source code and what I myself do as a developer, but also in the music industry. You know, the musicians are having a tough time because they're not getting the value, even though they're basically, you know, if you look at the numbers here, the publishers used to get something in the region of between 70 and 90% of the income that musicians earned from their records. So now the musicians are getting a much higher percentage of the actual revenue that they're earning, but the actual revenue they're earning is lower because people are willing to pay less. So there are some real challenges with open, and I don't think we should be, you know, it isn't all love and happiness. There are some very real challenges, I think, and we can't afford to ignore them.
So that's exactly what I just said, right? So in all of the open source businesses, when I've worked in six, that I've ever worked for, the P&L on the code makes it not worth selling the licenses. And that's just cold hard cash, boys. So it's, you can have all the peace and love you want, but it doesn't bear it out to put all those cycles into selling code rather than solving problems and delivering solutions with that code.
We've had quite a lot on... we've had quite a lot on sort of code and that sort of software, hardware side of things, but as of...
Can I just say, did you hands up those who do work with code, open source code? Yeah. So there's quite a chunk. We can go into discussion groups, and if you're particularly interested in open source, you might want to go there, but I'm really conscious we wanted to look at some of the things that are stopping people, things like open research, open education, open data as well.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, I think that's where I was thinking, you know, there's some other, I suppose, aspects, and Peter, you started to mention music and such like, and so some of the things which are transacted over the internet but use open licenses, and I saw Matt had his hand up, and I don't know if anybody from education might want to talk about both that open access.
How about we go to here and just actually, let's widen things out and just have a complete what do you call it, where people chuck up examples. Crowdsource. So who's creating things open, and why, Mike, for, you know, 10 seconds and then pass it on. We haven't heard much from this corner of it.
Something we're just doing now is the map of digital inclusion projects, which is effectively open data. It's available to everyone on the internet.
Yeah. Awesome. Another example.
I work in research. So we're doing a working on visualization of the internet in New Zealand at different levels, so web, internet. We're making all our code available for everyone to use with GitHub. So our company actually has a GitHub account where we share the code of what we do, and also we are pushing an internet open data portal, so to share all kind of data sets related to the internet openly for other people to use and make awesome things.
Hi, my name is Kasek. I'm from Papua New Guinea. It's a developing country, and previously things like computer engineering, software development was unheard of in university. We just learned what was there for us in textbooks and that, but recently, a couple of years ago, we started dabbling around with this thing called Arduino, and kids who never thought that they could build certain things, certain sensors and that sort of thing, we're building it now, and I think it's excellent. And one of the challenges we face with open source, as an open source user myself, about back in 2012, when I started using it, I installed a Ubuntu Linux on my machine, and people were interested, but one of the challenges was there's a lot of copyright pirated software available. So what it does, it just equates the price of a open source software to commercial software, and you know, why switch when I could just get it for free? That's one of the challenges that's faced with open source uptake. Thank you.
Thanks. Just from a slightly different perspective, I'm not a techie, but I understand the politics and I support the politics of free and open source software. So in my job, I try to apply those in terms of thinking about tenders and contracts. So for example, the Office of the Privacy Commissioner, we recently wanted to create a Privomatic. It's a privacy policy statement generator. We wanted to do that for small and medium-sized enterprises, so we asked for open source, and we wanted to do that in open source ways. So we had a local software company do that for us. It's all open source code, and we've put that on our website. So it's just a simple way for us. And what was interesting, and is the process of that, one of our staff has got to learn to code. as well. So it was quite a nice sort of integration there. So, and just a wee plug, we've actually got an open privacy good research fund at the moment, which is closing at the end of August, 21st, I think. So if you've got ideas about privacy research in relation to open source, do think about that as a place to seek some funding.
Can I just say I'm making really bad notes in the Google Doc? If I haven't recorded what you put properly, can you please go in and fix it for me?
In the etherpad doc.
Oh, in the etherpad doc. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
This is my third hour of facilitation. The habits are set. Yeah. Who was next?
Just moving away from open source software for a wee bit. There's a heap happening in other realms like education and research. And the business model argument there is quite a lot different because these projects are primarily funded with public funding. So it's not about getting a commercial model, it's about ensuring that there are mandates attached to that public funding, ensuring that stuff is made open. There's a ton of those projects happening already. We have 3 universities with open access policies, we have 100 plus schools with CC policies, we've got the 3 biggest heritage institutions in New Zealand, which is really world leading, have really spectacular open policies and practices.
Just
at the moment.
Don't check the 3 in case people don't know.
National Library of New Zealand, Te Papa, and Auckland Museum, which are the 3 leading GLAM organisations. This has all happened in the last couple of years. This is happening really quickly. Yeah. Again, the drivers for this are that this is in the public interest, public money is being used, there's a really good reason for these institutions to do this stuff. There are some implementation difficulties, which we can get into later, potentially, if this, you know, depending on the interest of the audience. Yeah, but there's a lot of, really is a lot of stuff happening.
If we can, you know, talking about business models and again, back in openness for academic and that sort of area, you've got a whole lot of very innovative business models as well that look around saying, okay, the libraries are already spending X amount of money on it. Could we do that in a more efficient way? So you end up with projects like Knowledge Unlatched where the libraries say, well, we would have spent X amount of money on content anyway, we're going to spend that amount of money but make sure that it's open so that anyone can get into it. And you find a whole heap of very different open access publishing models. Which ones are going to survive and which ones won't, I don't know, but there's already money in the system. And the question for a lot of open access publishing at academic level is not can we get money, it's can we use the money that we're already paying to end up with much better results.
I was just going to say that there's an interesting drive now. In the past, governments have seen that the use of their money to fund things has been focused on making it possible for private enterprise to amplify the value of the work that they've funded. But I think there's an increasing pullback that we're seeing now where the expectation is that taxpayer-funded content and any other taxpayer investment should be made available to the commons, should become part of the commons. And I think there's a real tension at the moment that's still being worked through between those two things.
Yeah, I was just talking to Zoe. I'm not sure if you met her. She's just started doing her master's in education something. So she was saying that she's looking through research. And there's a lot of research that's been done that she can't access because basically it's been funded through the Ministry of Education, whatever branch has funded it. And then, so that's 4 years of funding. And then when it comes to publish it, they decide, no, we don't want to publish this. Maybe this is too controversial. Maybe this will make us look bad. This is secondhand source. I'd like this to be fact-checked, but this, I mean, it seems crazy.
I can tell you from personal experience, I worked for a Crown Research Institute when I first came to New Zealand, and I was funded by a Public Good Science Fund grant to develop a new technology that had been identified as something they wanted to try for the forest industry, as it happens. And I spent several years beavering away on a prototype of software that implemented this concept. It was a computer vision mapping thing. And I wrote a lot of software which potentially had some commercial value, but due to political things within the CRI, it sort of ended up getting buried. It wasn't the CEO's favorite project. He had another competing project that he wanted to see happen because he was invested in the company that was doing it. And
I produced this work, and it was buried in the archives of the library of the CRI. And you'd have to know that it existed to request it as an external person. And you would have had to pay for them to print it and then post it to you. This was in the late 90s. I quit because I was disgusted by that approach. I thought if the Public Good Science Fund, which is a taxpayer-funded thing, is paying for me to develop something, then the public should have the benefit of it. And I was absolutely appalled, and it forced me to quit and start my own company, so, doing open source.
Someone's started bidding for the mic by entering in here. Open Glam, who wants to? Yes, I'll get the mic over here. Everyone's being awesome about jumping in too here, thank you.
So, Open Glam, once again, Glam Sector has been huge on trying to make things open. I actually, if I could very quickly, wanted to talk about some of the issues that face a lot of the open glam sector. So huge issues with cultural collections and being able to clear copyright. So talking about orphan works, you're talking about mixed works. If you say newspaper digitisation, so there's obviously a huge benefit to, say, New Zealand. If you had managed to digitise your newspapers from the 1930s, 1940s, both for directed research and being able to do text and data mining and all of that sort of stuff, and family research. Even if you get, say, the publisher to give you permission or blessing to digitise the paper, they don't own all the rights in every single paper. And there is actually absolutely no way that you can clear rights, and we don't currently have a way that without clearing those underlying rights, you can make it truly open. Because if you as an institution don't hold the rights, you can't give the permission to everybody else to use that. One other thing that is looming, of course, as well is TPP. If you do extend the copyright term by another 20 years, you take a whole lot of other stuff out of your public domain, and you're making that lag time before you can easily access those cultural materials just a little bit greater. Glam sector has been really good on a couple of things. One is that best practice for glam sector for things like digitisation is that you don't try and claim copyright over the actual digitisation, and that has been an issue in some parts of the world. So you say if the underlying work is out of copyright, then those efforts that we've taken to make that, for most GLAM institutions have been, we will not try and assert copyright over that, and that's really good. And they've also been very good, as a general rule, in stuff that they create, trying to put that out under things like Creative Commons licences. And the other thing, the other really interesting projects that they tend to do is looking into that crowdsourced open access stuff. So you do things like, we've got awful works, we don't know who the rights holder is, we don't know who these people in the picture are, we're not sure what to do about it. Can we throw it online, and can we get people to basically fix the metadata for us and work in a way where you suddenly get each other fact-checking and starting to get leads so that you end up with proper countenance for the item?
Yeah, can I just add to that? I was until a year ago in the National Library, and so, yay! But the Alexander Temple and National Library worked on a collection use and reuse policy that explicitly addressed open the orphan works. So I didn't know what orphan works meant until about a year and a half ago, but that's where you actually can't find the person who is the copyright holder. So it's been orphaned. But they've taken the... I'll put the link in here. But they've got a use and reuse policy which says that where there are works where copyrights are likely to apply but the rights owner is unable to be identified or traced after a reasonable search, the library will seek to provide a statement of copyright undetermined and after careful consideration of ethical issues. But pretty much it's, I think, my understanding is they kind of default to making it more available. But if someone says, oh, that's mine, then they respond accordingly, which is rather than being risk averse, oh, we can't get everything perfect beforehand, we'll say, we'll start imperfect and we'll be good citizens about it.
If people haven't seen it, Wayne has just chipped in a link to the open access tipping point, I believe. So there's a link there which we can maybe copy into the document perhaps so that it has a bit more, it's more a bit more obvious. That would be really cool. One of the things that the internet and the open movement have been symbiotic. They've evolved over the same period of time. And one of the unfortunate things that the open movement has also revealed is how completely ill-suited many of our institutions, like legal ownership, intellectual property, intellectual monopoly rights, like copyright and patents and various other things, are completely ill-suited to a digital environment where copying is essentially
zero cost. And so we're having to scramble rapidly. So if any of you aren't aware of things like Creative Commons, talk to that guy over there, Matt. they can talk to a lot of us about it. But yeah, if you're not aware of it, that's the kind of thing that will help us avoid digging ourselves deeper in the hole in future of having all these ownership-related issues.
So I think what we want really is a cultural shift, a sea change. I think part of the problem is we don't celebrate the success stories enough. We've got Creative Commons, and we've got people that are doing have small victories in private, and we're not getting the stories out there. We're not getting those stories out there effectively. So that we can actually move society in a way that the expected norm would become the commons. Because there's intuitive sense that if something's out there, it's part of our culture, it belongs to the commons, when in fact it actually does not. And I think by having these success stories like Open Glam, that we can actually move away from these little fiefdoms of content towards it becoming part of the shared commons. What really disturbed me a little bit this morning was there's the lady who was talking about the Maori culture basically being held behind patented systems. I think it's doing a disservice to that community, separating themselves off from a larger community, whereas we as a society could benefit from the knowledge and the values that they have to share with us, and there's a bi-directional process associated with that.
Thanks, Jacko. Yeah. Before you start, I'm noting that some people haven't actually said anything yet, so if you've got something to share, prepare while Bruce is speaking and be ready to stick your hand up at the end.
That's right. I actually just want to wind it back to before Jaco's comment. I'm sorry. Not in any way disparaging what he said, but it was the Open Glam thing. It just made me go bling, because one of the things I do is I contribute to Wikipedia. Not in a big way. I wander around fixing up vandalism, correcting typos, building new links, et cetera, sort of sub-editing. And one of the things that I see is they've got a statement they put on some pictures that are taken. Apparently the museums overseas that have a 500-year-old picture claim they've got copyright on that picture and trying to assert copyright. And one of the things the Wikimedia Foundation puts up in those cases is their belief that, in fact, a faithful reproduction of something that's in the public domain is also in the public domain. But, one day that's going to come to court and it's going to be a nasty blood-on-the-floor thing. So the more people that voluntarily Creative Commons their output, or if it's, an out-of-copyright thing, they don't try and assert any copyright, as this GLAM system was doing, I think it's just absolutely wonderful. I just wanted to say that. Thank you.
Yep. Can I just very quickly follow up on something? I want to just point out something that Jaco said that had to do with the fact that we don't take enough, so you don't celebrate the things that are successful in the open sphere. I just, as a challenge for all of us, I'd love us to all recognize, and we tend to take it for granted when it's in the open, or in the commons. And we should just be cognizant of the fact and publicize our appreciation when we feel it. Because the other thing is that I don't know if we want to talk about another element of this open question, but is the people who masquerade as open and try to trade on openness when they're not. We refer to that in the open source world as FOPEN.
it's like greenwashing. Just wanted to acknowledge that someone's been, he was using open, hi, unknown author, whoever you are. Unknown author's telling us that they work in Access, so have to, hi, Kevin. Kevin, be your voice. Shall I?
Come over here, mate.
Yeah. So, Kevin, do you want me to read out what you've written, or should we just stop and read for a bit? Can everyone read that?
Yeah.
Not everyone can, probably. It's small text. So he would prefer to use an open screen reader, am I right? But it's horrible. There isn't a, it's horrible, okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
You probably
use a mic, need to be accessible, Kevin.
Yeah, need to be accessible, need to actually follow the protocols of NetHui.
Yes, yeah.
And I didn't mean it about the horrible open thing at all.
No, that's okay.
I was deliberately winding Mr. Lane up.
I implemented this.
I win.
That's why I've got a bit of skin in the game.
Yeah, I mean, to a degree, I'm forced to use, and that feeds my laziness, I'm forced to use the applications that my clients use. So if they want to know about Word, I've got to use Word. I've got to have those things. But when I went and had a look at OpenOffice, it's really horribly accessible. So kind of, it goes against one of my other principles, which is probably the principle I have to stick to more than the openness. But yeah, I acknowledge that I don't use a lot of open because I'm too lazy to go through the paint that Peter mentioned.
Well, we're going through an incredible disruption right now, and there's a very uncomfortable transition that's happening between the open and the closed worlds. And the problem at the moment is that the investment that people make into these things, they're investing in the proprietary things because that's what everyone is using now.
Yep.
And it's a vicious circle of embedding more and more value in the proprietary stuff because that's perceived as where it's going to do the most good, but simultaneously it's undermining the things that are being done in the open. And this is a transition that's going to be painful no matter what.
Yeah. But what I do want to say is the screen reader I would use as choice is MVDA, totally open, developed by a couple of guys in Australia with a lot of help. Much better than the proprietary ones because you don't have to go pay $2,500 when you've only got a benefit to live on.
So that one of the things that you've pointed out there is you have two lots of principles going at once.
Yeah,
it's often the case.
Kind of conflicting. Yeah. But I do want to say the other problem it's got is they can't bundle it with a decent synthesizer because the decent synthesizer, as in the bit that turns the text into speech, so that you're not listening to Professor Hawking all day long. Those bits are not open. They're in the closed world, and they can't bundle it with a decent one. They have to bundle it with a Professor Hawking speak.
Okay.
And that's kind of hard. But it's really useful for me. If you just dip in.
Yeah. Before that, I just wanted to check in an example. That was a great Wikimedia Foundation. A couple of years ago, we had the national some Dutch national librarians visit. And apparently the Rijksmuseum is making a lot of their online imagery widely available for famous painting. I think they've got the Night Watch, and you can basically print it out and stick it on a car or on a mouse pad or on a t-shirt, and they're just saying, come and use our digital image library. Library expert colleague. Give that woman a mic. Yes, thank you.
Okay. I was just going to say, everyone go to the Rijksmuseum website because it's amazing. It's one of the big things for the Rijksmuseum was they wanted to make the collection searchable rather than, you know, having to go through normal sort of start at the top, find your thing. They want you to be able to throw in search terms, search by categories. They've got a category for, like, kittens. I'm not kidding. The other thing that they are doing is they're really encouraging people to share what they do. So they say, go, put this on a T-shirt, put this on a mug, use this in an artwork and share the results so that you actually get this, you know, hopefully very vibrant cultural community around these works. And it's, you know, I noticed there's a piece of thing going around talking about sharing and remixing and reusing. It's a really good example.
I was going to briefly talk about how we can support all of these creative endeavours. And one of the things I've been doing over the last year is actually giving my money to the people who are creating. So I think it's important that we start recognising that these creative people, they need to have a way of surviving. You know, the people writing open source, for example, they can't just do it out of the love of their heart. They do have they do need to be supported. Often, you know, like myself, I depend on a closed job. I'd love to be able to do it in an open environment, and if there was a way to do it, I would. Same with musicians and, you know, people making videos. And there are avenues now where you can give your money to people. I mentioned journalism before. I mean, if the Herald opened up a donation-based system, who here would do that? Am I the only one?
No.
Seriously? Because this is the thing is we have to start actually valuing some of these things. Okay, I think the Herald and other news sites, you know, they're providing a useful service that goes beyond blogging, and you know, it does provide that value add of actually doing the research and making sure that things are true. And similarly with software, we need to value, sure, developers scratching an itch can produce an interesting software, but we also need software which is deeper and appeals to people that aren't developers. And so the people writing that software, they need to be paid for it. And that goes right across the open area. We do want to be open. We do want to be able to have these things so that we don't replicate things in competitive businesses. But these people are professionals. They're very skilled professionals, and we need to find some way of being able to compensate them so that they can continue doing it in this open way. That's how I feel.
Thanks. Just what I did want to do was catch up on some of the chat, because I think there's been quite a lot going on here in conversation, and I want to make sure that the people who are with us in various places around the country are included. So if we just... Yeah, thanks, Rachel.
I'll scroll up.
Yeah, so that's probably roughly where we were. So I think there were some comments about... there were some comments about open washing, about the...
I'm just going to scroll through, so tell me where to stop.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's probably a
good one. So open access reached a tipping point. Yeah, more peer-reviewed journals under open access than when compared to closed journals. So Wayne's put in a link to that. Shifting culture. Sorry, I can't read that fast when it's scrolling. Cross the chasm from sharing to learning, and learning to share. So then Amanda made some comment about the indigenous knowledge. So I think that there are, I suppose, some cultural things that we need to consider in terms of that culture of open sharing, but you know, other cultures which might exist and how they butt up against each other. And Richard said it's come to court already, and I think that was a comment
about the copyright of replicate digitization
right,
of out of copyright works.
Yeah, I thought there was a comment. I think there was a comment. Maybe it's a bit further down that effectively in New Zealand there's no copyright on reproductions. Is that correct? That's wrong, entirely wrong. You can claim copyright on a reproduction in New Zealand.
We should, yeah.
I would kind of, it's an interesting one that, because if you think about, let's say, wedding photographs, and people think, oh, it's just a snapshot, but actually there's quite a lot of effort goes into making a really good copy of a reproduction and having the right lighting and the skills, so it's a real, there's more than one side to the issue.
And I think then towards the end there, Wayne has said that the right to earn, so this has fallen up on your point, Peter, that the right to earn a living is a fundamental human right. Yeah. You know, so that it, again, I think for me, out of some of this conversation, there are quite a lot of, you know, conflicting things going on, and how we perhaps see that as coming into, you know, the commons and those values. It's something which we have to, you know, we're still struggling with.
So just with my voice for the people who are new to this, the NC restriction as opposed to CC? Non-commercial versus...
Versus CC.
Well, so CC is Creative Commons. And under the Creative Commons license, there are a number of different flavours.
Yeah,
so non-commercial means that, I say, hey, you can use this, but you can't make any money out of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whereas if I don't apply non-commercial...
The problem with having creative so Creative Commons is a family of copyright based licenses which allow you to offer to reserve only some rights, not all rights. And you can then use the Creative Commons flavors to decide how many rights you want to give to the commons, essentially. And the problem is that there is one of the flavors of Creative Commons is a non-commercial flavor, which you can say that your work can be used for anything as long, well,
one of the things it can be used for is anything as long as it's not a commercial application. The problem is it's often very ambiguous what commercial actually is or what is actually commercial. So in many cases, it creates an incompatibility with your, if you've released your work under a non-commercial Creative Commons license, it creates major problems for uses that you probably would want to allow as the copyright holder. But because you've got the idea that you don't want other people making money off of what you've done, then you create this barrier. But it often has unintended consequences, is what I'm trying to say. So generally we would encourage people not to use the non-commercial variant of Creative Commons, even though it's available.
I'm conscious that we've been sitting in one space for quite a while, and it's probably a good time to move into groups and discuss one of our topics. So do you think, is it success stories a good one? Or who would like to go and talk about success stories, or do you want to divide? Okay, hang on, let's crowdsort this. Yell out something you would like to discuss with other people in a group. Oh, just stand up. Okay. Okay. Yeah. True. Yeah. We've got.
So we are in the double session. We've got quite a lot. Yeah. We've got another hour.
If we need it, we don't have to use
and
it.
We
so.
We don't have to use it all.
Yeah. So we're at the other sessions are about to start, aren't they? So. Okay. Has everyone had enough of openness? That's fine. Tea break time.
As they say in California, if your mind's not open, we'll pry it open.
Yeah. Cool.
I forgot we started on the quarter to. I just need to get used to that.